Do you think my bedroom, my previous life, before I absolutely, you know, fortuitous way I became a informal boy, as a professor at the university and my in the field of physics of fluids and my field of research, which might be interesting, was the simulating the origin and development of turbulence, which I had plenty during my time in politics. Education seems to be always in crisis. It's really a privileged subject for public debate. All the governments, either truly democratic or less democratic, claim that education is a priority. Why is that? Probably because people in general think that through education, or education, it's probably the best way to reach a level of dignity which otherwise is difficult to get. And now it's common sense to say that education is a key to progress. Let's say in the last 150 years in Europe, probably the only really successful reform in all countries, Western or Eastern countries of Europe, was in the education field. Now, today there are a lot of doubts about how to proceed with education. It's in every country you have always somewhere a debate about reforming the education system. And referring to really today, to our present situation, I think there are three fundamental aspects of the education system. One is the quality of education. How do we measure it? Second, the commitment of the educators, of the teachers, of the professors to their mission, because it's not simply a profession, it's like some kind of apostolate. And third, more and more, it's the individual effort of the students, which I must say it's decreased very much. Young people, for reasons I very briefly intend to discuss, are keen to less effort in order to acquire, to assimilate information, to assimilate learning, and I think that the result cannot possibly be better than what it was. Failure in the education system, I think, is the surest road to national failure. That's why, really, we always need to think, rethink, and do something about improving the education systems. I think I will not refer now to innovation and technology, only maybe in a marginal way. The great Argentinian poet Borges said that, can we afford not to educate? what really changed in and what didn't change, let's say, in the last 20 years? What did change dramatically is the level of communication globally. People exchanging their views, opinions and emotions with millions or tens of millions or hundreds of millions instantly and globally. This is, of course, a huge and obvious change. What didn't change, I think, and today, right now, today, we more and more see that, is that the political leadership continues to promote national interests, national identity. It doesn't seem that globalization is moving the people out of their national identity, out of their national feelings or interests. But education has a lot to do with promoting the national interests and the national identity. For instance, for this particular area of the Pacific Ocean, I think there is a great chance with the digital technology, the education at long distance. We can imagine that through some kind of agreements with the universities or even with professors, people here, through long distance digital communication, could be privileged and have the best professors in the world talking to the young people here, educating them, communicating them their science, their way of doing that. And this, I think, is one of the best ways to improve the quality of the education. I said, how we measure the quality. It's a very controversial thing. Some say the quality of a system of education is in the results of the students after they complete their respective degree of education. Yes, it's probably one aspect. It's not all. It's not all. We have failed education in many countries, in my country too, in the last, let's say, 20 years, because of the decrease, how to put it, of the commitment of the teachers, of the educators, of the professors, who think that their mission is not well understood. The Googleization, I would say, the Googleization of everything makes one of the results of this is that young people have access to any kind of information instantly, which doesn't mean at all that they personally made an effort in order to collect the information, to correlate the information, to innovate and to advance with something. Of course, I'm not against this kind of very easy access to information. We should remember that Socrates, in his time, was definitely against the books. He said, no, my students should memorize. Books means to have easy information. Well, now, with Google, what to say about this information? Which brings me to the third and very important for me, aspect of that kind of commitment of the students to work hard. There is a very interesting research in social neurosciences, which proves about the what makes a genius. And the result is, I think, not at all surprising. It's 1% talent, meaning what you have from Mother Nature, from your parents, 1%. It's 29% the environment, education, mainly. And it's 70% work, hard work. They make this research with the examples of big scientists, but also big great sportsmen. And this is the result of this very interesting research. How to motivate them? How to motivate them? The young people from very young age, let's say 6-7 years old, to the students in universities, in order to, as in my time and in your time, understand that only through personal effort you achieve something durable, something sustainable, something which can help you to adapt.
Yes.
I intended to be provocative, and probably I succeeded somehow. Only one thing now, back to about the reformers. You can easily see in almost every country there is always a debate about reforming. We have to be very careful about that. Probably these reforms are needed, as myself, in a way or another, I just indicated. But in order to succeed, the reform needs continuity, perseverance, because every reform at the beginning comes with a decrease. Then you achieve some kind of leveling, and then you have the takeoff. But until you leave, you reach the takeoff, people can get furious if they perceive that what's happening is in fact affecting the education reform. So I'd like to stop here with these aspects which I'm putting on the table. Quality of education, capacity of the people to adapt to education, personal effort of the young generation, and what means to reform the system of education in order to better advance the national interest. Thank you. Through social networking, which really helps. lot. Do you really prepare the people to being capable of adapting themselves to uncertainty, to changing conditions, to be qualified, to be ready, to acquire skills? I don't know. No, nothing comes without an individual effort. Well, that's my deepest conviction. Very good question, and I have some kind of fear that this question will come. To motivate, this is really, I would say, this is really related to the relationship between the student and the professor. That's why I insisted so much on commitment, the authentic commitment, the mission of the educators, of the professors. When there is such kind of special relationship between the students and the professor, one part, important part of the motivation is already acquired. In my time, for instance, I always gave to my students examples of how different former students of mine succeeded very well with that piece of information I gave them, with that piece of learning I gave them, with that piece of learning I gave them. Something very concrete, very easy to understand. It is always crucial when you explain something to the students, when you present something to the students, that what you say as a professor, you know perfectly, if possible, through your personal experience. My mentor, my professor, one of the most important scientists in Romania and Europe, told us repeatedly, what you say, what you present to your students, is very simple. Present those things that you master perfectly, that you understand and master perfectly, because those things they will understand and they will appreciate. I think that's one of the ways to motivate them.
Thank you very much. I can certainly see in what you said about young people in your country and in Europe. I can see a lot of that in the young people in Pacific Islands as well. Lack of motivation, lack of interest, reduced effort, willingness or interest in getting by with a minimum. But I think what's interesting in what you said is really the demand side, which I think for a lot of things like education is not really focus is really on supplying education, supplying knowledge, rather than on managing the demand for it or the interest in it. Because I understand that the root word for education actually means to draw out of the young person the genius in that person. Whereas education is now being pursued as sort of stepping into the children, this knowledge and this. It's not really drawing out that. Same goes for the teachers. It's really sort of forcing, in a way, enforcing certain duties and rather than drawing up out of the teachers. The commitment that you say is lacking to be in the interest. And so I think that's a very important point regarding the need to reform education. It's really to try and look at motivating, bringing the human factor involved. The last point I want to make is with regards to the education report. I think it's going to be difficult to agree on the and assume the right policy of taxation without agreement on the preferred policy of funding and the preferred kind of attitudes and values. And I think so society, by and large, needs to agree on what development needs before I think it can really foster or promote the right type of education to serve that.
Okay, I need to refer to a very fundamental fact, which is quality of life means access to education. So the first basic thing about education is to be accessible for as large as possible proportion of the young people. But without that, we are not speaking about the system of education. So that's absolutely basic, you know.
Thank you very much for all these experiences that you shared with us. I'm Mario Matao, a member of the local party. As I listen to you, it reminds me of our education system here in Tahiti. Because, excuse me to say, but it's sort of like a colonization system. When I went to school in my early days, in primary school, elementary school, and then college, when I was in elementary school, we were taught the history of France, not the history of the East. Mm-hmm. Okay? We had to learn their history. And also, they said to us, our ancestors are world. Meaning in all time, ancient time, the whole world today is French. You know what I mean? We're not taught like being Tahitian or Maori people, but we were taught like French people. In other words, we were taught to sort of clean our mind to become a French mind instead of a local mind. Still, we would say all that. But that was the system before. And as time went on, and it still, you know, it was hard. I'd like to congratulate our minister today, education minister, because he did a lot about doing things to say to the government, especially to the French government, hey, stop all that. Because I'd like to remind you, last year, there were a few of our, students from here who were intended to become school professors in college or in high school or even in university. But they had to go to France. They had to go to France and pass their family over there, or the, you know, the test over there. And it costs a lot of money. While students want to get all over there, it costs a lot of money. There's no help at all. The parents have to pay from their own pocket for their children to go over there and ask them. We call that that you provide as the capex.
Capex.
Yes. And as I have a daughter that went there last year. And she came back home, she was about over 20 of them that passed the past diplomas. But again, they said, all right, now you have to go to France. You have to go to France to follow what we call it a sort of a formation. And we said, hey, again, it's going to cost a lot of money. A lot of money. It's very expensive for our students to go over there because they have to pay their, what you call it, their residence over there, the work living and all that, and then it's cost a lot. And our minister has done a lot, and he went over and seen that. And finally, with the changes of the government today, things have changed also. So it's kind of hard for us here in Tahiti on this. School education, school as I heard you saying about regional prophets and all that, but we had a hard time with that. And all that today is getting, I think, the system is getting, as it goes over, and it's getting better and better. That's what I'm saying. Sorry. Thank
you. You are absolutely right that one fundamental trait of the education for young people here is to properly understand what they are, what their people are coming from, what they what is their identity. I just said that. This is absolutely valid for you. But in the meantime, you said it costs a lot of money to send people to France and so on. That's why I said that to put in place a very well cohesive, coordinated system of education at long distance, with very good professors, with a clear system of regulations, could a lot, and in the end, to have a diploma, which is a valid one, it's a struggle. It's a struggle of your government to reach such a level of the quality of the diploma. Absolutely, it's a struggle. But for people like you, maybe this is the solution. Because today, it's easy to have one of the best professors, like myself, on the to say, okay, are you ready to explain the physics of fluids, the way the fluids became turbulent easily in the atmosphere or in the ocean? Yes, but it's a struggle to put in place a system which at the end offers to the student a valid diploma.